Welcome, everybody, and this is a topic near and dear to our hearts. Great to see so many familiar faces, literally from around the world. Canine enrichment. We are incredibly honored to have one of the leaders in enrichment presenting today. Kelly Bolin is a certified animal behavior consultant with a master's degree in animal behavior and specializes in shelter behavioral care. Kelly is the former director of behavior programs for the Maddie Shelter Medicine Program at Cornell University, where she continues to serve as a consultant. Kelly also serves as a member of the Shelter Medicine Program Steering Committee at the Cummings School of Veterinary Medicine at Tufts. Kelly is the owner of Animal Alliances, an animal behavior consulting business in Massachusetts that helps private pet owners with behavior problems. Kelly conducts educational seminars for the public, veterinary staff, and shelter personnel, and consults with animal shelters across the country to help them address such things as stress reduction, environmental enrichment, safe animal handling, and canine behavior assessments. In her previous position as the behavior manager for the Massachusetts SPCA, Kelly conducted published research on shelter dog behavior evaluations. Kelly has a chock-full session today, so we're going to hold questions until the end. And so let's get right into this amazing content. I'll turn it over to Kelly.
Hi, everyone. I want to thank everybody for taking time out of their busy day to watch this webinar on enrichment and shelter dogs. I also want to thank the ASPCA for asking me to do this webinar and for offering so many great webinars for free to all of you. It's really an amazing service that they provide. I love the subject of enrichment because I'm so passionate about keeping captive animals mentally and physically healthy. I really feel it's our responsibility to do so, whether it be in a zoo where I used to work or in an animal shelter where I now spend my time. I even feel it's vitally important for pet owners to learn about enrichment because I truly feel that many owned dogs and cats are mentally and physically understimulating too, which can lead to behavior problems. So I hope that you enjoy the webinar and learn from it. I know that many shelters do enrichment these days, and I commend you for that. You might already be doing some of the things I'm going to present here. But many shelters are still struggling to give their animals basic care. And for those people, I hope that you find a few things that you can implement at your shelter that will not tax you too much. I pride myself at trying to give shelters easily implemented and inexpensive ideas to enrich the animals in their care. So I hope that I accomplish this goal with this webinar. And as you see on the first slide that's up, this is my definition of enrichment, providing an interesting, complex, challenging, stimulating, and variable environment that encourages the animals to explore, think, learn, engage, and be well mentally and physically. Next.
Thank you. Kelly, could you speak just a little bit louder, please?
Okay. So as I said before, I think that shelters should place a priority on programs that reduce stress and promote the physical and psychological well-being of the animals, because it's so important to keep these animals behaviorally healthy as well as medically healthy. And of course, it is the humane thing to do, and that's our goal as humane societies and animal shelters. Next. So why is enrichment important in our shelter environment? Well, first of all, shelter animals live in a stressful environment. We know that the shelter is stressful. It's stressful for not only the animals but the staff, I'm sure. And the animals are mentally and physically understimulated. And they're confined in a small area, whether it be a cage or a run, where they really have little to no control. And this lack of control is really very difficult for animals, because when you can't control your environment, you can't control what happens to you, that adds to a lot of stress. And so all of this stuff can lead to boredom, anxiety, and the development of behavior problems, including abnormal behavior that we sometimes see in the shelter environment. Next. So this is a video of a dog who is showing what we call stereotypic behavior. And this dog pretty much spends this whole day doing this. And you may have seen some of the dogs in your shelter developing these stereotypic behaviors. Now, not all animals in captivity develop stereotypic behaviors. Only a certain percentage of them do. But certainly when you see the development of these issues, it's very, very disturbing. And so our goal, of course, is to try to prevent this. Next. So So providing for the psychological well-being of the animals in our care does a couple things. It reduces stress. It provides physical and mental stimulation. It allows the animals more control over their environment. And it also prevents the development and display of the kinds of abnormal behaviors you just saw in that video. Next. So I think of enrichment in two ways. The first thing I think about is environmental enrichment. And environmental enrichment is when we modify the environment itself. And so we can do a bunch of things. We can make the environment more comfortable. We can provide more space for the animals. We can provide more choices for the animals. We can make it more stimulating by giving them views and stimulating their senses. And we can make it less stimulating by making it quieter or having them not be able to see other animals, which also can lead to stress. So that's environmental enrichment. Next. Now, behavioral enrichment, that's the other kind of enrichment, and that's when we're stimulating the animal's brain. We do that by giving them opportunities to perform species-typical behaviors and by giving them opportunities to think and to learn. Next. So in Dr. Frank McMillan's book, Mental Health and Well-Being in Animals, and his chapter on stress, these quotes come from that chapter, research in the neuroscience has indicated that brains of higher animals are constructed to function optimally when receiving a specific amount of stimulation. When too much or too little stimulation is presented to the brain, disorganization, instability, disease, and suffering may result. Next. And studies consistently indicate that mental stimulation is emotionally rewarding for animals, and there really is a strong motivation for animals to seek novel stimuli. And lots of studies show that animals would prefer to work for their food rather than have it given to them freely. And again, a quote from Dr. McMillan's chapter, inadequate mental stimulation gives rise to the unpleasant emotional state of boredom, which serves to motivate the animals to seek stimulation. So some of the stereotypic behaviors that you saw, like the pacing or the jumping and things like that animals develop in captivity, they actually think it is a form of self-stimulation because the animal is so bored. So that's one of the contributing factors. Next. So enrichment is actually required by law for captive primates, and I worked with captive primates for many years in the zoo field. Next. There was actually an amendment to the 1985 Animal Welfare Act that required all facilities housing them to promote the psychological well-being of the non-human primates. So any laboratory or any zoo that housed non-human primates has to provide enrichment for their psychological well-being. It's now the law. Next. And so when we look at primates in captivity, oftentimes this bonobo here you see on the left looks pretty bored, and on the right you see a stimulated environment, and that's the kinds of things we strive for in the zoo field. Next. So when I worked in the zoo field, I worked with lots of different species of primates, and simple enrichment strategies were really very, very effective. And so I used all kinds of things like soda bottles, and I would make wooden feeders and PVC pipes. Next. PVC is great because it's very easily cleaned. Use milk crates. Any kind of wood or PVC could be very, very useful for creating enrichment devices for these animals. Next. And my goal was to keep them busy. My goal was to make them work for their food, because research did show that a primate given a pile of food would choose to work for that instead of just eating that pile of food. And so anything that could stimulate them and make them work for their food was useful. Next. I also work with the animals in the rest of the zoo. As you know, elephants are extremely intelligent, and they need lots and lots of mental stimulation. Next. As do the big carnivores. And so giving them things, opportunities, again, to perform species-typical behaviors like trying to hunt for food or carry things around can be very useful for enrichment for these guys. Next. So my question is always, don't they deserve it too? Because even though these are companion animals that we care for in our shelters, they are in captivity in our cages, in our shelters. And so they deserve enrichment the same way zoo animals do. Next. So environmental enrichment is where we're going to start. And I say, wouldn't it be nice here? Of course, you know, you see just the concrete floor and the metal caging and really nothing more for the animals. Next. So a comfortable environment is really important. And so providing soft bedding, providing surfaces like platforms for them to get up off of the floor, just a comfortable environment for them to rest and be more comfortable is important. Next. So this video here was taken when I was the behaviorist at the MSPCA, the Massachusetts SPCA, and this is actually just a quick shot of the adoption floor. And you see it's a little bit of overkill perhaps, but it was a nice comfy environment for these guys where they had blankets and toys and even chairs in their suites, if you will. And boy, does that dog look comfortable. Now, can't the adopters picture that dog in their home when they see it sitting in a nice little chair in their kennel? Next. So the other thing is making the environment less stimulating. So, you know, we talk a lot about increasing stimulation in the shelter environment, and certainly that is a huge part of it. But sometimes decreasing stimulating is just as important. Next. So providing visual barriers. So you guys all know that when one dog is walked by a row of kennels, all the other dogs get aroused and start barking and going crazy. And so using visual barriers can be very helpful, whether you have the shelter that has the glass rooms, and this is one here on the right where we used actually wallpaper or contact paper to block their visual access. And on the left is a shelter that I've worked with, and those are actually just shower curtains and easily cleaned that are pulled during the time when the dogs are walked past to really cut down on the arousal levels in the kennels. Next. Quiet kennels are important. Reducing the noise levels in the kennel can really, really reduce stress. Next. So if you look at the noise levels in a shelter, they can exceed 100 decibels. One study done by the graduate student of Temple Grandin showed a shelter had a decibel level of 118.9 decibels. And if you don't know what a decibel is, it doesn't matter. You just look at this list here. Anything greater than 70 is considered loud. 96 is a subway train if you're down in the subway tunnel. 110 is if you're working a jackhammer. And 120 is if you're standing next to a propeller aircraft. And any sound between 90 and 100 decibels is considered to be in that critical zone, and that's the zone where we can feel it as well as hear it. So some shelter kennels can reach 100 decibels, and that's really harmful noise. Next. So one of the things we can do is work to teach the dogs that they get rewarded for not barking. And the Click for Quiet program can be very, very useful. And I'm going to explain clicker training a little bit later for those of you who might not understand it or have started using clicker training in your shelters. But basically, Click for Quiet is just when you walk through the kennel several times a day and any dog that is not barking gets rewarded. And it can be very useful to reduce the noise levels in your shelter. Next. Time outside of the kennel or in an office or a real-life room can also go a long way to reducing stress and giving the animal some enrichment. And so if you have a program where you can trade off dogs into the office space, in the lower right-hand corner, that was my real-life room when I worked at the MSPCA. And, you know, after I was done behavior evaluations in there for the day, the dogs could be rotated in to have a comfy environment for a little while. Next. This little video is just a short little video showing the back office at the MSPCA where we would rotate dogs so that they could just spend a little time de-stressing out of the kennels and just have some access to people and just get out of that environment for a little while. Next. So when we think about enrichment, it's also really important to think about all of the dog's senses because we can utilize and think about their senses as we develop things to stimulate them. Next. So we're going to talk first about their auditory stimulation. We're going to stimulate them, their auditory sense, and research has found that classical music actually calms shelter dogs down. We can use classical music. We can also use any kind of soft, soothing, new age music. All of these sounds seem to reduce stress and shelter dogs. Next. There's one CD called Canine Lullabies, and the research on this music, which is the underlying beat, is the heartbeat of a human. They actually started using this for premature infants, human infants, and then someone decided to try to see if it was useful for dogs, and certainly it can be. Next. This is a video of a shelter that I've worked with that implements the Canine Lullabies CD in the afternoon. And as you can see, as we go through the video, that this music actually has a nice calming effect on the animals. This is during open hours in the middle of the afternoon at this shelter. So it's a nice calming CD that can really be helpful. Next. The other CD that's available to shelters, and lots of research done actually in the shelter environment, is the Through a Dog's Ear CD, which is psychoacoustically designed music. It's solo piano classical music, which is really, really nice. Next. And this video shows it's a video of actually from their research in a shelter on this music. And again, this is during open hours as the dogs relax. And so if you get on the Through a Dog's Ear website, you can actually, they give for free to any shelter one CD. And so if you don't have this CD already, I urge you to get on their website and get yourself one. Next. You can also, there's lots of CDs available, and we use these CDs in behavior work to desensitize dogs to certain sounds that they have trouble with. But we can also use it just to give the animals in the shelter some auditory stimulation and keep them socialized to the sounds of a human household. So that can be nice too. Next. You can hang some wind chimes in your kennel and they'll ting-a-ling-ling when the doors open and the wind changes. Again, just a little momentary auditory stimulation can be very helpful. Next. The next sense we're going to talk about is a dog's sense of smell. We know that their sense of smell is their number one sense. Dogs have more brain matter dedicated to olfaction than anything else. And so stimulating their olfactory sense is a great way to give them psychological stimulation. Next. And so we can introduce scents into the environment. Lavender scent has been shown to have a calming effect. I also like to use food-scented aerosol sprays because food-scented aerosol sprays seem to stimulate the dogs really well. Next. We use olfactory stimulation in the zoo. When I worked in the zoo field, we used to troop on over to the elephant barn every morning and get a pile of poo and bring it on over and spread it in the lion exhibit. And then the lions would spend, you know, a huge portion of their day sniffing the elephant poo. So also very useful in the zoo. Next. We can use dried spices, sprinkled on bedding, cloves, nutmeg, cinnamon, these things, just a little teeny pinch, just sprinkled on their bedding will give them a little bit of olfactory stimulation. Next. Some shelters have what we call a scent of the day. They mix up some extracts. Here we have vanilla and almond and coconut and banana, and they have every day, they have a different scent that they spray in the kennels. Next. And this video shows how easily and quickly you can stimulate the animals in your kennel because all you have to do is walk through. It takes a few seconds to spray the spray. And watch this dog. I want you to watch him air sensing. And because their sense of smell is their number one sense, just a few seconds of air sensing like this can go a long way to stimulating these dogs mentally. And so you might think, well, gosh, it only lasts a couple of seconds. But, boy, you've just stimulated the biggest part of a dog's brain. And so you've done a huge job at giving them some mental stimulation. Next. There are other senses of smell. It's not really a sense of smell, but dogs have an organ called the vomeral nasal organ, and the only purpose of this organ is to analyze pheromones, and pheromones are chemical messages emitted out of specialized glands. And next, we have for dogs a synthetic version of the pheromone that a nursing mother dog emits to calm her puppies while they're nursing. And so Adaptyl can be used in the shelter environment as well. It's a little pricey, so you want to make sure that you put it on your wish list for people to donate to your shelter. But collars can be real helpful for dogs that are particularly stressed, or you can put a diffuser into a smaller room. Next. The next sense we're going to talk about is their visual sense. Next. So back to the zoo. So here's a little cute little video of a chimpanzee being stimulated by some bubbles. Hopefully you're all enjoying this. Next. And we can use the same kind of procedure to stimulate the dogs in the shelter, just blowing bubbles for a few seconds. This video going to play? Just blowing bubbles for a few seconds can go a long way to giving the dog some visual stimulation. And the other benefit is that there's nothing more fun than blowing bubbles, and so the staff gets to have lots of fun as well when they're enriching the animals in their care. Next. So now we're going to switch over to behavioral enrichment. So as I said before, behavioral enrichment involves providing opportunities for the animals to perform species-typical behaviors, things that are normal for them, and providing opportunities for the animals to think and learn. Next. So opportunities to perform species-typical behaviors we'll talk about first, and we're talking about dogs today. Next. So let's talk about some of the things that dogs do naturally. Chewing is a very important behavior for dogs, especially when they're anxious or bored. And so if you can provide safe chew toys to your dogs in your kennels, that can be very, very useful to stimulate a normal dog behavior. Next. Digging is also a normal dog behavior. Dogs love to dig. Sometimes it gets them in trouble at their homes. But digging is a normal dog behavior. Some do more than others. But if you put a digging pit in your play yard, that can go a long way to helping stimulate the dogs as they dig for hidden treasures. Next. And remember, their dog's number one sense is their sense of smell, and that's why we use dogs for search and rescue and drug detection and skin cancer detection. Next. So we can use this tendency when we are in the shelter as well. This is just a short little video of teaching a dog some tracking, meaning we laid a track of scent, and the dog is kind of following the track. And the end result is a pile of hot dogs. Next. The newest thing in dog training world is the nose work, and what nose work is all about is providing the dogs with opportunities to search for hidden things. And so this is just a little video of a dog searching for a hidden treat in a variety of different things, the boxes, bags, and such. And you can easily do nose work at your shelter with your shelter dogs. And again, nothing more stimulating than stimulating their sense of smell. Play, of course, is also really important. Dogs love to play, some more than others, but certainly most dogs love to play. Next. And so providing them with toys in their kennels can be very, very stimulating. And even if they don't play with the toy, there's actually a research study out there that shows that people think a dog is more adoptable if there's a toy in their cage, even if they're not playing with the toy. So that's a human thing. But certainly providing them with toys to play with is also important. Next. This is a shelter I work with in their play yard, and luckily they had a donation to buy the shade cloth. But if you look at the play yard, they have pools down there. They have a little bit of agility equipment. It's a nice place to run the dogs. So having a place for the dogs to play can be very helpful. Yes. Every dog needs exercise. Exercise is really important. and not just walking, but aerobic exercise. And so providing them with some kind of aerobic exercise can go a long way to stimulating them. Next. Agility is a great sport. You may or may not do agility with your own dog, but agility is also a nice way to stimulate the shelter dogs. Next. Some shelters are lucky enough to have donated agility equipment. Next. But a lot of shelters don't, but you don't need to because you can build your own. The very middle picture you see there, that's one of the shelters I work with, and they actually had the Eagle Scouts build their activity yard. It's just things for the dogs to climb on and jump over and go through, and you can set that up on your property and just give the dog some stimulation that way. Next.
Hey, Kelly, this is Susan. I'm wondering if I can just pop in a quick question because
yep.
we've had it twice. Are there any toys that you would ban dogs from having access to?
Well, I can't think of any that I would actually 100% ban, but you have to be very, very careful about the kind of toys you provide for the dogs. You have to watch them, make sure they're not destroying and eating the toys. You know, how dogs sometimes will eat the stuffing or they'll eat the squeaker. So it's really about monitoring them at first. Some shelters are really concerned with the toys that fit down the drain, so drainage is also a problem in some shelters. In terms of chew items, one thing that I didn't mention before but I think is really important to mention is that if you're going to put things like rawhide or other kind of chew items in the dog's kennels, you really need to make sure that you've done a really good behavior assessment to make sure we don't have resource guarding with those animals so that the public who is interacting with them doesn't get aggressed upon. So that's really important. So I think monitoring is the key.
Great. Thank you.
You're welcome. Okay, so now we're going to move on to dogs being social animals. Dogs are actually what we call social obligate species, and humans are a social obligate species as well. And that means that we need social companionship to stay emotionally healthy, and so do dogs. Next. So providing opportunities for social interaction with their conspecifics is really important. Next. Doing play groups at your shelter can go a long way to giving the dogs not only mental and social stimulation, but also physical stimulation. Next. Here's a nice video of a pool party I conducted when I was at the MSPCA. So just having pools out there for them to play with. So playgroup concerns, it's very important to talk about safety when you're talking about playgroups. You got to make sure you make good matches with the dogs. You want to introduce them properly. You don't want to just throw a bunch of dogs out into the activity yard without first introducing them. I like to have the dogs do a little parallel walking first and get to know each other, and then we kind of put them in the area on leash and eventually, you know, we can drop the leashes and eventually take the leashes off. But observation and supervision is really important. We want to make sure we keep the arousal levels down to a reasonable level. When you have a group of dogs that get overly aroused, oftentimes you end up with fights, and we want to try to prevent that as much as we can. I like to teach shelters what I call a positive interrupt signal, which is any dog who goes into a play group knows that when you blow the whistle, they should stop what they're doing and come to you for a treat. And it's real easy to train them to come to you to the whistle. You just do a little bit of Pavlovian conditioning, which I'll talk about in a minute. And you also have to be prepared to break up dog fights because sometimes fights do happen in play groups, and being able to break those fights up is really important. So you want to have a fight kit in your play area. Next. So what's in a fight kit? The things that I have in a fight kit is an air horn. An air horn will break up probably 90% of fights. Now, the only problem with the air horn, of course, is it's going to scare all the dogs. So if only two are fighting, everybody's going to be, you know, they're going to be traumatized by the air horn. But if your goal is to stop the fight, then it's something reasonable to do. If the air horn doesn't break up the fight, I like to throw a blanket over the dogs. When you throw a blanket over the dogs, they get disoriented, and then you can use the blanket to pull them apart without getting bitten, although pulling dogs apart when they're fighting, there's always a risk of getting bitten. And the last thing is a break stick. A break stick is just for emergency situations if you have a dog that latches onto another dog and won't let go. You do have to know a little bit about how to use a break stick, and I think the ASPCA has had actually a couple of webinars that talked about this. I just saw in the chat thing came up, someone said something about water. If you have a hose available, certainly hook up the hose. You can throw a bucket of water on them as well, but these are the things I like to have in my dog fight kit. I find the air horn works pretty well. Bucket of water can also be very useful. Next. Okay, co-housing. Now, co-housing can be a great social enrichment for the dogs. Next. But you also have to think about safety. When dogs are co-housed, sometimes we have redirected aggression. Even dogs that live together in a home and were surrendered together, so you're housing them together, can redirect aggression onto each other once they get aroused, which is problematic. Sometimes we have resource guarding, and it certainly does make it a little bit more difficult to manage the dogs because you want to take out one to show somebody and the other one's trying to get out, and so it's a little bit harder to manage them. But again, you want to make sure you make good matches. You want to observe the animals for a couple of days, make sure that they're doing okay together. You want to not put any valuable resources in the cage just because we don't want to have resource guarding issues. And you want to feed the dogs separately. So again, don't set them up for failure. So no valuable resources and feed them separately. Next. Human social contact, very important too. We definitely want to keep them socialized to humans. So sitting with them, petting, brushing, playing, anything you can do with the shelter dogs is going to be helpful for them. Next. So what do people want their dog to do most with them? And it is to just be with them. You know, I consult with pet owners all the time, and you know, they just want the dog to lay down next to them, and the dog wants to do something else. So we also have to help the dogs in the shelter learn this little thing. Next. So we play the do-nothing time in the shelter is also really important. This is time when we just sit with the dogs and spend some time with them quietly rather than always taking them for a run or a walk. Sitting quiet, nothing is very, very enriching and very helpful for their potential adopter. Next. Calm interactions outside the cage can go a long way too, because a lot of times the dogs get totally aroused and excited when people come up to the cage. So they need to learn that sometimes when people are on the other side of the cage, there's just going to be some calm time. And it doesn't always mean they're being taken out. Next. Massage can go a long way to calming an animal. Just like with humans, massage really can calm you down and relieve stress. Next. And when I was at the MSPCA, I had a woman who was a massage therapist, and she came in every Tuesday morning, and she massaged one by one the dogs on the adoption floor. And so look at this nice little pity enjoying her massage. And you don't need a massage therapist to do that. You can do it yourselves. It's just basically massaging the dog. And now we're going to move on to the other thing, which is the other part of behavioral enrichment, which is providing opportunities for the animals to think and learn. So food acquisition challenges can be really, really enriching. So like I said earlier in the webinar, we have found that animals do prefer to work for their food rather than to get it freely. And so providing them with opportunities to work for their food is really one of the most enriching things you can do. Next. In the zoo field, it's what we do all the time. So this little video shows you a Saki monkey who's working for its food. Next. And this lovely video that's going to play, this is anteater enrichment. So anteaters are really interesting animals, but this little feeder ball here with whatever's in there, ants, I suppose, so that the anteater can get the ants out of its little feeder device. Next. So we do that a lot in the zoo. We use feeding enrichment for the zoo animals all the time. So why not use it in the shelter field? And so I tell shelters, try not to use a bowl if you don't have to. I actually tell all of my private clients this as well. I don't think any dog should be eating out of a bowl. I think dogs should be provided opportunities to work for their food, whether they're in the shelter or they're in their home. Feeding a dog in a Kong can prolong the eating time, and it also provides them with lots of mental stimulation, of course. So if you can do this at your shelter, it's very, very helpful. Kong Company, I'm pretty sure they still do. You can ask for a donation of seconds that they can't sell, and they'll send you a box of Kongs. You can also ask for donations from your community for Kongs, and you fill the number of Kongs that the dog would use. You know, you weigh out their food, and that's how many Kongs they get. If it's a big, giant dog, they might get 3 Kongs, but the idea is to provide them with some enrichment. Next. So here's a little video, and everybody's seen a dog eat out of a Kong before, but I'm going to put that in here anyway. So just think about how long it takes a dog to eat out of a Kong as opposed to wolfing down their food out of their bowl. You can also, of course, use Kongs for just an enrichment in terms of giving them a little bit of peanut butter in their Kong halfway through the day to give them something to do. Next. Hanging Kongs makes it a little bit more challenging, so you can put a little rope through the hole at the end of the Kong and hang it up after you fill it or before you fill it, and gives it a little bit more of a challenge for the dogs. Feeder balls. There's lots and lots of feeder balls out on the market, and the thing about these feeder balls is they make it a challenge for the animals to get their food. They have to roll it around or move it just right so one or two pieces of kibble fall out. Next. The Premier Company makes a lot of these nice feeder ball type toys. Unfortunately, they're a little bit more expensive than most shelters can afford. And so finding some kind of cheap alternatives is really very helpful for most shelters. Certainly you can ask for donations of the other kind, but this is what I like to use. Any kind of plastic jug that's cleaned out really well, soda bottles and things. If you're going to use a soda bottle, make sure that you take off the little plastic ring that is near the cap, because that little ring dogs can choke on. But using any kind of cardboard or paper bags or any kind of plastic container cleaned well can go a long way to enriching the animals and stimulating them to get their food. Next. So this is just a little video of a dog using a soda bottle. A soda bottle has treats in it, and notice that there's a little dish of wet food, but the dog would rather work with the soda bottle to try to get those treats. Okay. And this dog in this video is not eating a full box of Equal. We certainly wouldn't want to do that. But there's food and different things in that box, and so the dog is being stimulated by getting the food items out of the box. Sometimes we put one box inside of another box inside of another box, and the dogs will tear the box up and get to the food item in the middle. And again, this is all about mental stimulation. I got this video off of the internet, actually, so I'd love to give credit, but I loved it so much. If you are watching and this is from your shelter, thank you for the video. I call it Boxo Fun. And so this dog is tearing up the box to get to all the goodies inside. And look at the people watching. And when I was in the zoo field and I did enrichment with the primates, and you noticed from some of my pictures that I used bottles and boxes and milk crates and things that were not natural to the primate environment, of course. You don't find those things in the jungle. But I convinced the management to allow me to do it as long as I put up a sign explaining why we were doing it. and I convinced them that it was absolutely the best thing to do because people stood at the exhibits a lot longer watching the animals because they were actually doing something instead of just sleeping in the trees. And so the people learned a lot more about the animals. And the same goes for the shelter. So, you know, they see the dogs doing something and being active, and that's also real important. Plus, of course, they see that you're providing the animals with something to do. Next. Lots of commercially available puzzle feeders out these days, and a lot of them are pretty expensive. But you can, next, you can make some homemade ones. This is another video I got offline. And again, if this is from your shelter, thank you for providing it. But this is what we have is a coffee cup holder from Dunkin' Donuts or someplace, and with tennis balls in the holes. And there's a treat under each tennis ball. And the dog has to figure out how to get to the treats underneath. Gotta love the music accompanying it too. And so you can use these kind of cup holders. You can also use muffin tins, cupcake tins. That can be really useful as well. Next. Ice blocks. We use ice blocks all the time in the zoo field as well. Freezing treats inside ice blocks and hanging them or just giving them to the dogs so that they are working for those treats. Next. So again, we use them in the zoo field as well. Next. Here's a dog working on his hanging, frozen popsicle. You see little treats frozen in there. Next. Okay, training at the shelter. Also, can go a long way to helping provide mental stimulation, social stimulation, gives the animals some control over their environment when they learn that they can do certain behaviors to earn reward. It certainly can increase adoptability and make the animals more easily managed. So training in the shelter is also a form of enrichment. Next. I like to use clicker training. As I said, I come from the zoo field, and in the zoo field we use clicker training for any animal. If you think about the dolphins and how they train them, this is the method that we use. It's a very effective method of training because its principles are based in the science of how animals learn. Next. So clicker training uses the two major forms of learning. The first form of learning is called classical conditioning, and that's just association learning. That's what we call Pavlovian conditioning. And the other form of learning is called operant conditioning. And that's just learning through the consequence of your behavior. If the behavior is rewarded, you're going to do it again. So those are the two forms of learning that clicker training utilizes. Next. So how it works is the first thing we do is we pair the sound of the click with the delivery of a reward. And this is what we call classical or Pavlovian conditioning. So we just do click, treat, click, treat, click, treat. And once it's conditioned, the clicker becomes a wonderful way to speak to the animal because the click means that they just earned a reward. So what we do is we click when the animal does something we like, and that tells them that that behavior earns a reward. Next. Then communicating with a dog is like speaking or going to a foreign country and not knowing the language because dogs do not understand English. They certainly can learn words, but they don't understand English. But clicker training is like using a translator. And so the animal understands what the click means. It means they just earned a reward once we condition it. Next. So clicker training is communication the animal understands. It's positive and hands-off. And it's very mentally stimulating because it makes the animals learn to think. You know, they have to think about what they just did to earn that click. And it's also really fun. Next. So why do we use a clicker? The clicker is a clear signal. It carries no emotion like our voice does. It can quickly mark the behavior you like if you have good eye-thumb coordination. It requires no processing in the brain, and what that means is when we speak to a dog, they have to process our words to try to figure out if they know any of those words. But the clicker only means one thing if we condition it well, which is I just earned a treat. And so through classical conditioning, the animal understands its significance. Next. So we use it in the marine mammal field. This is how they teach the marine mammals all the amazing things that they teach them down at SeaWorld and different places. You notice this dolphin trainer has a whistle in her mouth. It's the same idea. Dolphin trainers use whistles. Dog trainers use clickers. Next. So clicker training in the rest of the zoo, again, we use it for mental stimulation. We use it to give the animals more control over their environment, and we certainly also use it a lot to improve husbandry. Next. So we teach the animals to station at certain places. We teach them to respond to cues. These are some of the primates I've worked with. Next. This is a place I worked down in Texas where these ex-lab chimpanzees were housed, and this one is being presenting his hips for an injection and then his chest so we can listen to his heart. Next. And this guy is even taught to pee on command in the little PVC pipe, all done through clicker training. Next. We use it to shift animals from their outside exhibit to their inside holding and vice versa. Next. Moving into a restraint cage. Next. And here's a nice little video showing an obedient lion. So now this lion doesn't necessarily need to know these skills, but it provides them with some stimulation, and it certainly makes managing the lion a lot easier. Next. We use a lot of target training in the zoo field. Target training is just teaching the animal to touch their nose to a target, a stick or a piece of plastic, any kind of target can work. Next. So here's a video of some tigers learning how to touch a target. I will say it's not wise to feed the lions with your fingers. One of the zookeepers lost a tip of hers doing this procedure, so things were changed a bit. Next. And this is that similar kind of target training with the shelter dogs. So just simply being outside their cage and having them target to anything. Even here, Brian is having the dog target to his fingers. And the click happens right when the dog touches his fingers. And look at the dog, how excited the dog is to have this mental stimulation as well as this social stimulation. Okay, so training the shelter dogs, we want to start with the important skills that they need to get adopted. And those skills are sit at the cage front, don't jump on people, and don't pull on your leash. Those are the things that are going to get the dogs adopted. Next. So first impressions, of course, are important. Teaching the dog to sit at the cage front rather than jumping up. If the dog jumps, you walk away. If they sit, they get a click and a treat. Next. So here's a little video of Kate at the MSPCA working on sit at the cage front with the dogs on the adoption floor. Now she is luring them right now with the treat, although this is just the beginning of this work. Notice this dog is going to jump up at her and she leaves. But pretty soon we just walk up to the cage and if the dogs sit, they get a click and a treat. Without being cued. And that way they'll do it to the shelter visitors. Next. Four on the floor to open the door. That's a nice program to have. That means you never open that cage door if the dog is jumping. So if they jump, you close the door. And they have to have four on the floor. Certainly sit would be nice, but at least four on the floor to open the door. Next. This is at a shelter I worked with that has the glassed-in rooms, and this dog was a jumper, and every time someone came in to visit, he would jump. She, and so we were working on teaching her that jumping on people actually chases them away. and finally we were able to enter because she stopped jumping. Next. Dogs jump on people that walk up to greet them. Also, it's another thing to work on. One person holds the dog, the other greets. If the dog jumps, that person leaves. So the dog learns that jumping chases people away, and if they don't jump, they get a click and a treat and also get some attention. Next. Pulling is another bad behavior that we see in dogs. Dogs have opposition reflex, which means they pull against pressure, so pulling is a big problem. When you're working with a dog who is a pulling, a couple different suggestions. One is to stop all forward movement when the dog pulls. So if there's tension in the leash, you basically stop like a tree. And then if you're using clicker training, you can click and treat when the dog is not pulling. And pretty soon they realize that pulling doesn't get them anywhere, and not pulling not only allows them to keep going forward, but also a random click and treat. Next. Some tools that can be helpful at your shelter if you're so inclined. The head halters like the Gentle Leader or the Halty or the Snoot Loop. There's lots of different kinds of head halters out there that can be helpful. You do have to desensitize the dogs to these tools. The front clasping harnesses can work really well in your shelter, however. They don't require any desensitization, and the idea is the leash comes out of the front of the chest, so when the dog pulls, the pressure pulls their chest sideways. So they can be very helpful for pulling dogs. Next. Knowing some basic behaviors makes a dog more adoptable. Everybody wants to adopt a smart dog, of course. Next. So just teaching them those few basic things can go a long way as well. Just sit down and come to get them started with that using a little bit of clicker training. And of course, teaching a dog a simple trick is very, very impressive to potential adopters. People think it's so amazing when dogs can learn a trick, but to a dog, shaking hands or rolling over is just like sit or lying down. To them, it's just a behavior. Next. So here's a dog just learning how to wave or showing you a wave. If that video is not going to work. Okay, let's go to the next one. And that doesn't look like it turned into a video either. Oh, here we go. Nope. Sorry, everyone. We're trying to find these videos, I guess. There we go. Just something very simple like that can really impress an adopter. If you say, oh, look what he can do, it's a great way to get that dog out of the shelter. Nice little spin. Okay, thank you. And getting your staff and volunteers into classes. You can have a class once a week where staff and volunteers bring the dogs to a dog training class. That's really fun for everybody. Next. So getting your enrichment program started. Explain the importance to the staff and volunteers, and I know many people are watching this webinar, so hopefully you learn the importance. Have everyone come up with a list of enrichment strategies they want to try. Give everybody their own clicker and bait bag. Ask for some donations if you can't afford them. I like to empower the staff and put them in charge of one or a few animals, and so it's their responsibility to come up with enrichment for that particular animal or those animals. And then you can have a contest, like the best enrichment of the week contest. Once it becomes part of the day, it doesn't feel like an extra chore anymore. And so if you can get your enrichment program started, that's really the first step, of course, is get everybody enthusiastic about it. Next. You want to keep track, have some kind of a dog enrichment log to keep track. Next. And in that log, you just have for each animal, you could have a chart like this. Where it lists all the different things that you implement at your shelter and which things each dog got and on which days. So you can keep track and you can vary things because obviously you can't and don't want to do everything every day. So one day you'll spray the air freshener and the next day you play tracking games or whatever. And so keeping a log like this can be really helpful. I'd be glad to send anybody who wants a copy of this a copy. Next. And enrichment is not just for the animals. So I always say to the shelters I work with, you know, why did you get into this business? And everybody answers to help animals. And you didn't get into this business to clean cages all day and to work with the public all day. You got into this business because you love animals. So spending even a few minutes with them, enriching their lives, adds to your work satisfaction. And so I think it's really important that you are empowered to do the things that you want to do to enrich the lives of the animals in your care. Next. Do we have the time? Everybody knows shelter workers are overworked and underpaid, but you have to make the time. Just a few minutes a day goes a long, long way, and so some of these things that I've presented here today don't take very long, and so you just want to get a few minutes each day to try to enrich the animals in your care. Next. And then we have happy animals. Next. And happy humans and now happy animals. Sorry about that. Okay, and that's the end. And the next slide has my email, and I'd be glad to take any questions you have after the webinar. You can shoot me an email if you want any kind of forms or anything that I can give you to help you with your enrichment program. Please do shoot me an email and let me know.
Kelly, this is fantastic. We have just a couple more minutes, and I'm going to grab every second if we can. We had a couple of questions about enrichment. One was, are there any special considerations for animals who are housed long-term, months or even years? Anything that you would do differently?
Well, nothing that I would do differently. What I would do is make sure that those animals get enrichment on a daily basis. As you know, it's not the best thing to house an animal for months or years in a cage. These are social animals. They need social companionship. And so all of these enrichment strategies can go a long way to help those animals. But I think, you know, if an animal's at your shelter short term, you know, you might get away with not providing too much enrichment. But if you know this is a long-term animal, like it's a law enforcement case or something like that, enrichment is imperative. And so I urge you all to please, please implement these programs.
Great. We had a couple of questions around household items, equaling trash-seeking dogs once they get into the home. What's your thought on that?
Yeah, I've gotten that question several times when I show those pictures or those videos. And, you know, this is my thing. First of all, dogs are scavengers. And so some dogs will scavenge whether they got a cardboard box in their shelter or not. And a lot of things are very environmental in terms of, like, in the shelter environment, here's what you get because we're trying to stimulate you. That doesn't necessarily mean they're going to get in the cupboard and grab the crackers and pull them out. A dog that would get in the cupboard and grab the crackers and pull them out would probably do that whether you ever did this kind of enrichment or not. I don't find it to be a big problem.
Fabulous. We did have a question. Are there dogs using feeding devices who give up due to frustration in your experience?
Yes, there are. There's some feeder devices that are hard, and so when you look at the commercially available ones, like with my private pet owning clients, I have a couple that are really easy that I start them out with, and I say, okay, once your dog has mastered these, you can get some of the harder ones. And you got to, again, like everything else, you want to supervise and observe and make sure they're not eating or destroying the item, but also make sure they're not getting frustrated because they can't get it out. And if they are, try to find something that's a little bit easier.
Fantastic. We did have a question about group housed dogs and treating and sharing resources. Have you had success in those kinds of situations, or what are your recommendations?
Yeah, in terms of resources, again, you know, when we do behavior evaluations on shelter dogs, we are oftentimes, most of the behavior evaluation procedures out there have a component where we look for possession aggression towards humans, but none of them have a test that looks for possession aggression towards other animals. And we certainly could, if you were going to co-house the animals, you could certainly do a test like that, but that doesn't mean that they, you know, if you test one or two different items, that if you give them something else, they won't fight over it. So when you have group housing or even just, you know, double housing, you've got to be very, very careful about the resources you do provide them. Now, you can teach them all some impulse control if you have a group housed situation, you can teach them all to sit for a treat and teach them impulse control of waiting till the other one gets treats. Same kind of thing I do with pet owners who have multiple dogs in their home. That's great for those dogs. So in terms of training, I think it would be real useful. But in terms of just leaving resources and toys and bones and things in the kennel when there's multiple dogs, I'm not sure if that's really wise.
Great. Kelly, this has been fantastic. I'm scrolling through some of the comments in chat, and people are just loving the creativity and the actionable items. So I think you'll probably be hearing from some folks.
Wonderful.
But thank you so much, and thanks, everybody, for joining us. We hope to see Kelly back here on another topic.
Excellent.
Have a great afternoon. Thanks so much, Kelly.
Thank you.